George Joseph Smith. A horrible man with, yes, I'm going to allow myself the pun, a fatal fascination for women. Brides in the bath, Smith. Confidence trickster, bigamist, thief, murderer. George Joseph Smith gave early indications of his talents as a scoundrel. He was only 9 when he was taken from Roman Road, Bethnal Green, where he was born, and sent to reformatory for 7 years. He emerged completely unreformed, and like most professional criminals, opened his unpromising career with some contributions to the simple theft and stolen goods industry. He was imprisoned from time to time, and in 1896 got 12 months hard labour for larceny and receiving. On his release, he went to Leicester, and at the age of 25, married for the first, and in the eyes of the law, the only time. Not that Mr. Smith did it straightforwardly. He introduced himself to 18-year-old Beatrice Thornhill as George Oliver Love, and under this ironic pseudonym, married her against the wishes of her family. In 1900, the young couple were separated for 2 years while Smith served another prison sentence. And on his release, Beatrice wisely withdrew to Canada. Smith now embarked on the general career of swindling and exploitation of women, which would fill the remainder of his life. In Bristol, where he described himself as a general dealer, he employed Edith Pegler as a housekeeper and in 1908 married her. In the sight of heaven and by the reality of a steady commitment, Edith should, I feel, be seen as his real wife, though the marriage was in fact bigamous. But Smith for once used his own name for the ceremony, and he neither robbed, deserted, nor murdered Edith. Instead, he returned to her with the proceeds after each of his subsequent marriages. Needless to say, she had no idea of the reality of his career, but believed him to be travelling around the country dealing in furniture and pictures. In Southampton, he met and married Sarah Elizabeth Freeman. She believed her husband to be George Rose, antique dealer, and cheerfully made over to him her property of £50 in cash and £260 in bonds and savings. Mr. Rose then took her up to London, and on a visit to the National Gallery, excused himself with the promise to be back in a moment. While Sarah waited, George raced back to their rooms in Clapham, where he packed up all her clothes and possessions and made off with them back to Edith in Southend. Mrs. Rose came out of her short-lived marriage with 3 empty tea chests and a bicycle. She had, however, retained her life, whereby she did better than Smith's next wife. This was Bessie Mundy, a 33-year-old bank manager's daughter with £138 immediate money in the bank and a regular income of £8 a month. Smith met her in Bristol in 1910, married her in Weymouth a few weeks later, laid hold of the £138 and went back to Edith, abandoning Bessie. He explained his disappearance in a vile and lying letter accusing her of having given him a venereal disease. By an astonishing coincidence, he ran into her again 2 years later on the front at Weston-super-Mare. Far from reviling him as he deserved, Bessie was overjoyed to see her husband, Henry Williams, as he called himself to her. And the revolting Smith promptly used her forgiving nature to reconcile himself to her. He claimed that he'd been looking all over the country for her. He set about squeezing more of her capital out of her solicitors and took her to Herne Bay, where he rented number 80 in the High Street and set up a plate as an antique dealer. Next, he took Bessie to a solicitor, and the two drew up wills in each other's favour. Her death would now be worth £2,500 to him. 80 Herne Bay High Street lacked a bath. Bessie went with her husband to the ironmonger's, and she herself beat down the shopkeeper from £2 to £1.17 and 6 pence for the second-hand iron tub in which she was to die. Smith's next move was to express solicitous concern for the curious nervous fits he detected in his wife and of which she remained sublimely unconscious. He had her examined twice by a doctor who could find nothing wrong and prescribed mild sedatives. Dr. French was accordingly unimpressed when he received a note from Mr. Williams on July the 13th asking him to call round as I am afraid my wife is dead. But this time, Mr. Williams' diagnosis of Bessie's state of health was absolutely accurate. Dr. French arrived at the High Street to find Bessie in the bath, her face upright, partially submerged, her feet out of the water, resting on the end of the bath. The soap was tightly clasped in her hand. The two men lifted her out onto the bathroom floor and applied artificial respiration. Hopelessly. Bessie was dead, and the doctor agreed that those fits must have been genuine, leading her tragically to pass out in the bath and drown. At the inquest, Smith wept bitterly, and the coroner observed sympathetically that there was no evidence on which to censure the husband at all. Smith acquired the £2,500 from Bessie's solicitors. He also returned the now unwanted bath to the ironmongers, still unpaid for. He rejoined Edith in Margate. Quite clearly, southern coastal towns had a marked appeal for him, possibly because they often contained holidaying spinsters who could be encouraged into a vacation romance if they were suitably prosperous. Anyway, it was in Southend the following year that Smith met 25-year-old Alice Burnham at a Methodist chapel. When he found that she had savings worth several hundred pounds, he improved the acquaintance and went with her to Buckinghamshire to meet her family. They took an instant dislike to him, but poor Alice was smitten and insisted on going through with a marriage at Portsmouth. Smith had prudently insured her life for £500 before taking this step, and he followed it by demanding that Mr. Burnham hand over £100 he held in trust for his daughter. Mr. Burnham demurred and demanded some proof of Smith's identity and parentage. He little realised that Alice was privileged to be the second Mrs. George Smith, the second bigamous wife to receive her husband's gift of his genuine surname. But Smith was furious and wrote his infamous coarse postcard, "Sir, in answer to your application regarding my parentage, etc., my mother was a bus horse, my father a cab driver, my sister a rough rider over the Arctic regions, my brothers were all gallant sailors on a steamroller. This is the only information I can give to those who are not entitled to ask such questions." After Burnham had unwillingly disgorged the money, Alice made a will in Smith's favour. The couple then moved to Blackpool, where they made a particular point of taking lodgings that contained a bathroom. On December the 12th, they moved into Mrs. Crossley's at 16 Regent Road. The same day, Smith took Alice to see a doctor. She complained of headaches, though Dr. Billing could find no cause but mild constipation. The following evening, she took a bath. The Crossleys were annoyed to see water overflowing in the bathroom and causing a damp patch on their kitchen ceiling, but they hesitated to disturb the tenants. They were themselves disturbed some time later when Smith shouted down to them, "My wife cannot speak to me. Fetch the doctor." There had been another tragedy. The inquest recorded heart failure. Smith buried Alice as cheaply as possible, saying when the Crossleys and the undertaker remonstrated, "When they're dead, they're done with." Mrs. Crossley was most unimpressed and shouted "Crippen!" after him as he left to rejoin Edith in Southsea and recoup his insurance and inheritance from Alice. 1914 saw him back on the matrimonial prowl. As Charles Oliver James, he married Alice Reville, whom he met on the seafront at Bournemouth. He took her to London, robbed her of savings and clothes, absconding rapidly on the plea of going to the lavatory, as he had done with Sarah Freeman. Miss Reville was the third lucky woman to survive the experience of marriage to Smith. Not so Peggy Lofty, a clergyman's daughter who married him at the end of the year. She was 38, disappointed in love the previous year, self-relegated to the spinster role of lady's companion. John Lloyd swept her off her feet, married her in Bath and took her to London, where they found rooms in Bismarck Road off Highgate Hill. The very address made more contribution to the great war effort now engaging England than did the swindling bigamist. It changed its name swiftly to Waterlow Road. Smith followed a more habituated pattern. He took Peggy to a doctor, who found no evidence cause for the fits of which she, or more precisely, her husband on her behalf, complained. But the visit and the solicitude were recorded. And the following day, Mrs. Lloyd took a bath. Mrs. Blatch, the landlady, heard a little splashing. She heard Mr. Lloyd playing Nearer My God to Thee on the harmonium in his room. She heard him go out of the front door and let him in again a few moments later, when he apologised for having forgotten his key and explained that he'd been out to buy some tomatoes for supper. She was quite unprepared for his cries for help and demands for the doctor. Peggy had drowned in the bath. And the inquest on January the 1st recorded death by misadventure. But this time, it had happened in London and not a remote seaside town. The accident was just freakish enough to merit a report in the News of the World. And never has sensation-selective journalism been so fully justified. In Blackpool, Mr. Joseph Crossley, and in Buckingham, Mr. Charles Burnham, both read the report. So did Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, who collected newspaper cuttings of oddities. They all wrote at once to the police that this tragedy seemed altogether suspiciously similar to the very curious death of Mrs. Alice Smith. The police were waiting outside the solicitors when Smith turned up to start proceedings to recover Peggy's money. After a hopeless attempt to assume yet another identity, he admitted that he was Smith and that his marriage as Lloyd entailed the trivial illegality of causing a false entry to be made in the register. He was confident that he could be charged with nothing else. He was wrong. The police charged him with the murders of Bessie, Alice, and Peggy. Most unusually among murder trials, Smith's set a legal precedent establishing an important point in law. It is widely believed that English justice, insisting that the accused is innocent until proved guilty and nothing may be brought before the court but the facts of the specific crime with which he is charged, is the best in the world. For lawyers, it certainly may be. Smith could only be tried for one murder at a time, and with the brilliant Sir Edward Marshall Hall defending him, he might have been acquitted had the facts of Peggy Lofty's death alone been put before the jury. Marshall Hall argued desperately that any discussion of Smith's previous bereavements was irrelevant, prejudicial, and inadmissible. Of course, for a court genuinely anxious to arrive at the truth, a defendant's previous reputation is an important part of the record, even though it might be humane to keep it out of sight in the bad old days, when it was a capital offence to go about with a dirty face and the prisoner was forbidden to testify on his own behalf. But in Smith's case, the prosecution argued successfully that they must present a pattern of identical accidents which ceased to look accidental once the pattern was perceived. When this had been admitted, Marshall Hall's case was hopeless. Sir Bernard Spilsbury and Professor Wilcox both testified that, in their opinion, Smith had pressed his wives' heads under the bathwater with his left hand while pulling their legs sharply upwards with his right arm. A police experiment on a nurse in a bathing costume had proved that unconsciousness came so quickly if this was done that it was very hard not to drown the victim. The nurse survived, but it was a closer call than anyone had anticipated. Smith was convicted. In some repellently unctuous letters, he expressed deep penitence for his earlier wickedness, but total innocence of murder. By sheer Uriah Heepishness, he persuaded both the prison chaplain and the Bishop of Croydon that he was a devout convert to Christianity and actually innocent of murder. Obviously, in the flesh, he had some quite incomprehensible plausibility for some people. I can't see it at all myself. But then my training has been in the analysis of written language, and Smith's letters are completely unconvincing. And his photographs always remind me of a schoolmaster I disliked, so I can never understand his appeal to women and bishops.